Good morning. We continue to celebrate the resurrection a week from Easter. We come together to worship as a corporate body, and we're thankful in this time that we can at least gather this many of us. I want to share a quote from Paul David Tripp, and he said, "Corporate worship is a regular, gracious reminder that it's not about us. We've been born into a life that is a celebration of another." I'll let you read the announcements, except for the one regarding next Sunday. And next Sunday is a bit of a special presentation for pastors' sermons for the last while. And we've put quite a bit of work into it, and I think that it will be meaningful and enjoyable. The scripture reading is from Exodus 33, 12 to 18. And as I shared earlier, on my way in, I was listening to a broadcast, and the pastor said, "We stand alone in the word of God." And that made me think of the song that we always sang, the B-I-B-L-E. Yes, that's the book for me. We stand alone in the word of God, the B-I-B-L-E. So reading from Exodus 33, 12 to 18. "And Moses said to the Lord, 'See, you say to me, bring up this people, but you have not let me know whom you will send with me. Yet you have said, I know you by name, and you have also found favor in my sight. Now, therefore, if I have found favor in your sight, please show me now your ways, that I may know you in order to find favor in your sight. Consider, too, that this nation is your people.' And he said, 'My presence will go with you, and I will give you rest.' And he said to him, 'If your presence will not go with me, do not bring us up from here. For how shall it be known that I have found favor in your sight, I and your people? Is it not in your going with us, so that we are distinct, I and your people, from every other people on the face of the earth?' And the Lord said to Moses, 'This very thing that you have spoken I will do, for you have found favor in my sight, and I know you by name.' Moses said, 'Please show me your glory.'" Let us pray. Lord, we thank you that we can come together to praise you in song and in reading and in prayer. We thank you that it is about you and your graciousness to us. And we pray that you will help us focus now as we come together. We pray for the offering, and we know that you're God, you don't need our offering, but we give it with a grateful heart to your graciousness to us. Please bless us now and help us to stay focused. Please bless Kevin as he brings you the message. In your name, amen.
Good morning. Wow, people. There were half as many people here this morning in the first service. They were less enthusiastic, and that was better than what you just gave me. Good morning. There you go. There are a couple of you happy to be here this morning. That's great. So I was, first service, same as this, I was reflecting on when Jeannie was talking about the B-I-B-L-E, that's the book for me. The weightiness of some of the things we learned in Sunday school when we weren't too big to grasp it, right? The one more jumped in my brain, and there's one thing that God wants from us, right? Can anybody spell that song out? Sunday school, camp, anyone? O-B-E-D-I-E-N-C? What did I just spell? Oh, there you go. Okay, that wasn't too quick for you. So anyways, yeah, it was. I really enjoy the jumping back in time to the things we learned in Sunday school, because there's a lot of meat there. So this morning, we're going to have a pastoral prayer here. And is there any specific prayer requests that you all would like us to pray for as we go to prayer this morning? Yes, sir. Well, that would be wonderful, wouldn't it? Yes, thank you. Yeah, it's wearing on all of us. Tamara.
We had youth last night.
Cool beans.
Prayer request for family and a praise item for family.
Okay.
So, just as in general, our families in our church and in our community.
Okay, thank you. Yep. Anyone else? Okay, let's bow before the Lord this morning. Dear God, we thank you, as always, for the opportunity to come into your presence corporately. And as we just think about the COVID world we're living in right now, that's something we really need to not take for granted. There was a lot of days we couldn't come corporately into your presence. And we thank you, as we're doing two services, but we get to fellowship together, and we thank you for that. Help us to never take that for granted, that your presence is where we need to be, whether it's in church together or wherever we're at. God, I want to lift up the prayer requests that were made mention of now, that the COVID thing is it's wearing on us. The mental health issues that are going with, the fact that we can't do with the things we like to do and to be with people. You've created us to be a community, and it's hard, and there's a lot of challenges that we're not used to, we don't like, and we're struggling with. And we pray that you would help us to seek your face to make sure that, yeah, we're frustrated, but we need to be safe, but we need to be with people too. And we pray that you give us wisdom as we do that. And we think of the families, as Tamara was mentioning, that there's challenges. It's hard. Just whatever the specifics of Tamara's requests were, God, you know what they are. We don't need to. We just laid that at your feet. We also want to lift up our seniors, and I think specifically of Lloyd right now, as he's got a lot of health challenges. And I thank you for how you've used him in his health challenges. He's been in hospital, laying on the hospital bed, sharing you with the person beside him, and that's just very cool. And we know that he's struggling right now, and we pray that you would lay your hand upon him. It's not that he doesn't know you're there, but sometimes it's really nice just to feel your touch really close, God. We pray that you would do that for him right now. And I think of the other seniors in our communities and the different challenges, and I thank you that Lois is better today than yesterday. And I pray that you would be John and Mary as they've got new challenges in their life, and all of our seniors and their sway, their look at the COVID thing, because it's different for them than it is for some of us. And it's a challenging time, God, and it's really challenging for them. We pray that you just lay your hand upon them, give them strength. There's some loneliness challenges there. Lord, you are always with us. And I pray that you would just give them comfort in that. I want to also think of those that are serving you in different parts of the world. I think of the Mackenzies and what they're doing. And I think of the Hartwigs and what they're doing, and that specific prayer request that that Cindy shared with us, with that lady and family that is in their circle of influence. God, I pray that you would help Daryl and Cindy to minister to them, but also that you would be glorified in that situation. And I think of Turtlemont Bible Camp and Howard and Kathy, and the uncertainty as to what their summer is going to look like. They can do all the prep they want, but it may or may not come to fruition. And we pray that you'd just be with them in their scenario as well, Lord. And I feel like I've mentioned COVID an awful lot, but it is a big thing right now, as we may be on the edge of a third wave, and it's going to change our world again. One thing I pray that you'd help us all to keep very clear in our brain is that this may be frustrating, annoying, and all those things to us, but it doesn't surprise you. God, you knew this was coming before you said, "Let there be light." And nothing surprises you. You've ordained it. You will get us through it, and help us, God, to just comfort ourselves in that you've got this sorted. Nothing surprises you. Right now, as we move on into our service, I pray that you would be with those that are going to be leading us in music and taking us to the foot of the cross, God, as well as Kevin as he speaks, that whatever comes out of people's mouths, that it would be your spirit that we hear, and that we would be drawn closer to you through everything that is said and sang and done in this service. Thank you so much, God, that you are here with us, your presence is with us, and we pray that you would bless this service, that everything that is said and done would glorify you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
The front of your bulletins have the part of the scripture for this morning's sermon, and Genesis 33, I believe, and in that passage, Moses is talking with God, and they're being sent to the promised land, and he's like, well, who will go with me? And God says, I will go with you. And how awesome to know that God is going with us. We can be in God's presence, not just here. We can be in God's presence wherever we are. He is with us. It is such an awesome promise, such an awesome thought. Let us sing and worship our Lord and Savior this morning.
There is now a hope that lasts beyond our days. For the one that once was buried lives again. Now the tomb is bare and empty, and the stone is rolled away. Praise the risen one who overcame the grave. All you brokenhearted, all you worn and weak, come find living water, everlasting streams. To the wandering spirit, lost and searching, wanting something more, find the risen King who overcomes the world. Let there be dancing in the darkness, and let our song break through the night. Lift your voice and sing that Christ is King, for Jesus is alive. No more condemnation, no more doubt and fear. For our sin and shame, they have no power here. In His resurrection, perfect love has set the captives free. Praise the risen King who stands in victory. Let there be dancing in the darkness, and let our song break through the night. Lift your voice and sing that Christ is King, for Jesus is alive. Let there be dancing in the darkness, and let our song break through the night. Lift your voice and sing that Christ is King, for Jesus is alive. Hallelujah. Death is undone, hallelujah. Jesus has won, hallelujah. We overcome, oh in Jesus, oh in Jesus, hallelujah. Death is undone, hallelujah. Jesus has won, hallelujah. We overcome, oh in Jesus, oh in Jesus, hallelujah. Death is undone, hallelujah. Jesus has won, hallelujah. We overcome, oh Jesus, oh Jesus. Let there be dancing in the darkness, and let our song break through the night. lift your voice and sing that Christ is King, for Jesus is alive. Let there be dancing in the darkness, and let our song break through the night. Lift your voice and sing that Christ is King, for Jesus is alive. Lift your voice and sing that Christ is King, for Jesus is alive. You are good. You are good when there's nothing good in me. You are love, you are love on display for all to see. You are light when the darkness closes in. You are hope, you have covered all my sin. You are peace, you are peace when my fear is crippling. You are true, even in my wandering. You are joy, you're the reason that I sing. You are life, in you death has lost its sting.
Other name, Jesus,
Jesus, my heart will sing no other name. Jesus, Jesus, my heart will sing no other name. Jesus, Jesus. What your gift is complete. So I trust you, simply trust you, Lord, with every part of me. Jesus, only Jesus, help me trust you more and more. Jesus, only Jesus, may my heart be ever yours. Jesus, only Jesus, help me trust you more and more. Jesus, only Jesus, may my heart be ever yours.
Amen.
Good morning, everyone. I hope and trust that you are all on your... I can just yell. You know what? I would preach better if I just yell. I was camp speaking one year, and a lady approached me afterwards because I didn't bother taking a mic, and she says, "You're the only camp speaker I've ever heard that could yell loud enough that they didn't need a mic in this room." I thought, that is the best compliment ever. I'm the loud guy. It's all good. All right. Everyone's doing well. Lots of coffee in the system. It's good, 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 good. Cool. As you can see, I just got my Bible back from the shop. It was due for an upgrade, so... Yep, nothing but the secret weapon on there. That's all good. This is the second time I've got to preach this sermon today. So you'll be hearing something on repeat from what was already shared. But I noticed that, man, my head is in the fog. Like I just cannot formulate sentences to save my life this morning. And I realized yesterday as I was repairing my Bible, I mean, not only is there the gracious amounts of duct tape holding this thing together, but I also used contact cement. And contact cement is a little fumey. And it is an aroma that lingers. So every time I open this thing, I'm just hit with this wafting fumes. And it's like, I think it's taking a toll on me. It's like, usually you got to go to a conference to have a spiritual high, but I'm getting it right now. I have been journeying through the Old Testament a little bit, and I came across something that I found rather entertaining. I just want to share it with you before we get into the meat of this morning. Maybe. Aha. A little treasure I found in good old Leviticus. Leviticus chapter 13. And I see some of you might be affected on this one. This is verse 40. When a man has lost his hair and is bald, he is clean. Congratulations. I see some of you in the back. Applaud yourselves. You're clean. If he has lost his hair from the front of his scalp and has a bald forehead, he is clean. But if he has a reddish-white sore on his bald head or forehead, it is an infectious disease breaking out on his head or forehead. Oh, you're enjoying this now, huh? The priest is to examine him, and if the swollen sore on his head or forehead is reddish-white, like an infectious skin disease, the man is diseased and is unclean. The priest shall pronounce him unclean because of the sore on his head. The person with such an infectious disease must wear torn clothes, let his hair be unkempt, cover the lower part of his face, and cry out, "Unclean! Unclean!" As long as he has the infection, he remains unclean. He must live alone, and he must live outside of the camp. How's that sit with you all? Hey, I'm getting there. As the priest in this situation, I feel we could have a little lineup here in front. But what I was struck with as kind of comical is that you must cover your face and walk around declaring your uncleanness. So I'm just curious if anybody woke up with a zit this morning. Like, did your wife say, "What is that growing on top of your head?" Because I think it would be great to have a lineup of people outside as you greet one another and before you shake the hand, have to say, "Unclean, unclean." Anyways, that was just a little treasure from Leviticus. It made me smile this week, and I thought, you know what? We could all maybe use a little smile. So like I said, this morning my head was in a bit of a fog, and we're going to be all over the map today, and I apologize for that. I just do your best to track with me. There's a lot of verses that I'm going to be throwing at you and a lot of ideas that will all tie together, I promise, but just bear with me. But as I said, that little nugget of gold came from Leviticus, and I don't know what most of your reading habits are like, but Leviticus isn't exactly somewhere I tend to spend a lot of time. In fact, my Bible reading pattern looks a little more like Genesis. Oh, that was awesome. Reading about the patriarchs, the fathers of the faith. Good, good. And we move into Exodus. And oh, Moses and the Pharaoh, the plagues. Hey, that's pretty cool. And oh, they're delivered. The Red Sea is parted. They cross on dry land. This is like the greatest provision of God ever. What a great story. But then they go up on Mount Sinai, and God speaks the Ten Commandments, and all of the Israelites are gathered at the foot of the mountain because they can't approach God in his glory, in his fullness, or they will die from the overwhelming presence of God. Think about that. You enter the presence of God, and it kills you. He is so holy, it kills you. He doesn't smite you, but the holiness of God ends your life. That just baffles me. So good. Then it takes kind of a hard left turn. Because then God's law turns into describing how the tabernacle is made. And what's even more grueling, after you've read through all of these chapters of how the Ark of the Covenant is supposed to be built, and how the table of fellowship was supposed to be built, and the lampstand, and all of these things regarding the tabernacle that you have just invested your time into, going, okay, I get it. Well, then they actually build it, and they describe exactly all of those things again, how big, how long, how wide, twice over, so you get the double benefit of knowing what this tabernacle looked like. It is a grueling read, and we haven't even got to Leviticus yet. Then we get to learn how all the sacrifices worked, and so on, and so forth, and I find just as I'm reading that we turn the page a little bit, and it's like, well, the burnt offering, grain offering, yeah, I don't really have to do that anymore, so I'll flip the page. And you get to the stories of, like, Nadab and Abihu, and I'll read that. Actually, can anybody tell me who Nadab and Abihu are? The first service did not get this. Nobody. Oh, you are so wrong. Who? That is correct. Nadab and Abihu. This is a great story. If you haven't read it, you need to go. I thought you did it on purpose. Nadab and Abihu offered fire that was unworthy to God. They got caught up in the excitement of, hey, you bring us the sacrifice, and like, God's fire. And God got so upset with their fire, he sent fire and consumed them as the sacrifice. Great stuff. How about, I'm going to forget how to pronounce his name. Yeah, you got me all flustered. I'm just going to read it. Bezalel. There we go. Bezalel and Oholiab. Grant gave away the ending. Who's Bezalel and Oholiab? Oh, it's like you guys were here in the first service. Man, not only were they craftsmen, actually, they were craftsmen, but if you're trying to remember these names like I just struggled to do, there's Bezalel and Oholiab. Oholiab, he built the tabernacle. Yeah, that's how I got it. Bezalel and Oholiab are the first documented cases of spiritual gifts, in my opinion. Because the Lord said, I have selected these two men who are going to craft the tabernacle. And you begin with people who started as slaves in Egypt, making bricks without straw, and suddenly anointed with a gift that on the turn of a dime can craft gold and all sorts of woven things together and a spiritually anointed craftsmanship. Man, I'm a construction worker. I did not wake up one day, go to work, and be like, all the glory of here's what I built. In fact, my first couple of years looked a little more like, oh, you built that? We're going to have to take that apart and start over. But we got these great stories in the Old Testament, and as I've taken a little bit of time to be at home and calve out my cows this spring, I said, you know what? I'm going to put in the work and take a little bit of time to dive into some of these things. And I got to tell you, the fruitfulness of the past couple weeks has just been overwhelming. What God has opened my eyes to and revealed to me in this season through these texts surrounding the tabernacle, I'm just overwhelmed by it every time. And in fact, the emotions caught me a little bit this morning, and then as I went back and reviewed it a couple times, every time I get through these notes, I'm just taken by who God is and what he's done. So will you join with me this morning? Let's begin in a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, you are so good. You are alive. You are a king. You alone are worthy of our praise. And so God, we want to offer you our sacrifice of praise, our bodies as living sacrifices, for you alone are worthy. God, we give you all of the glory. And I just pray over this room right now that if there is any spirit that is not of the Holy Spirit, that it be rebuked in Jesus' name, and that your spirit alone would fill this room, that your spirit would come and dwell and make a home as it did upon the tabernacle in the tent of meeting. And God, as we look into these scriptures, I just pray that you would anoint my words and anoint the ears of those who are about to hear them. God, remove me and may you speak. Your words, not mine. In Jesus' name, amen. So a scripture reading this morning, I just thought of it more as an introduction because in a lot of ways, that's where the story really starts. And that may be tough to understand because there's a lot of subcontext before it going into it and a lot coming out of it. And something happens that I want to read the fulfillment of it. And we're going to pick up. And like I said, we're just going to be all over the map today. So just please bear with me. But if you would turn with me and look at Exodus chapter 40, and I'm just going to jump straight to verse 34. Because after this conversation that God has with Moses, where Moses cries out on behalf of the people, coming from a place where God first says to Moses, you know, forget these people, I'm going to bring them out here and destroy them. And Moses pleads on behalf of the Israelites and say, what does that say to the nations about who you are as God if you do not go with us? See, God promises Moses, he says, I'll make you a great nation, forget all these people. And Moses, being the humble man of God that he was, pleads with the Lord to not forsake his people. And I think the significance of what we're about to talk about really brings that context to light. As if you found it, picking up in verse 34, the cloud covered the tent of meeting, and the glory of the Lord filled the tabernacle. Moses could not enter the tent of meeting because the cloud had settled upon it, and the glory of the Lord filled the tabernacle. In all the travels of the Israelites, whenever the cloud lifted from above the tabernacle, they would set out. But if the cloud did not lift, they would not set out until the day it lifted. So the cloud of the Lord was over the tabernacle by day, and fire was in the cloud by night, in the sight of all the house of Israel during their travels. So as I get reading about this tabernacle, and again, it's documented twice, and so whatever I missed the first time through, I got it the second time. A couple things stood out to me, and so I'm just going to point to a couple verses, because as we put the pieces together, I think we've got some significant context to both our new covenant and the old covenant. And so if you will turn with me, just a couple things I want to point out. Let's first look at Exodus chapter 16, verse 33 and 34. So this is a promise we get. As you'll remember, for those of you who grew up in church, hearing this story of God's miraculous provision. God did so many signs and wonders through Moses as he journeyed these people out of slavery. first parting the waters and bringing them across the Red Sea on dry land. God takes them into the desert, and as they complain and cry out to God, "Have you brought us here to die?" God says, "I have heard you, and I will send manna and quail." And the manna, like dew, it says, grew on the stones every night, and they were to collect only as much as they needed for that day, because God's provision is renewed daily. It takes no faith to collect what you need for the month. It takes faith to know that today's supply will be renewed tomorrow. That is how the grace of God works. The grace of God is sufficient. His mercies are new every morning. And so we have this manna that is formed on the rocks, and God makes this. Exodus 16. Moses said to Aaron, "Take a jar and put an omer of manna in it. Then place it before the Lord to be kept for the generations to come." So Moses instructs Aaron, take some of what showed up on the ground today, we're going to put it in a jar, and for generations to come, we're going to be able to look at this and be reminded of how God has provided for his people. We see the fulfillment of that moving on to chapter 25, verse 30. Put the bread of the presence on this table to be before me at all times. What table? Well, in the tabernacle. You guys familiar with the tabernacle? Let's put a picture up there. This is what the tabernacle looked like. We're told that we have a curtain that surrounds the courtyard. And before entering into the tent of meeting, into the tabernacle itself, there's the altar. Behind the first gate, behind the first curtain, is the lampstand and the table. We're going to talk about all of these things in a minute. And then, as I'm sure many of you have heard, is another curtain that separates the holy place from the most holy place, the Holy of Holies. And behind the Holy of Holies is the Ark of the Covenant, where the Israelites have placed the stone tablets that were carved out by the fingers of God, the Word of God, the promise of God contained into this box and protected by cherubim that Oholiab and Bezalel, yes, so finely crafted. Only the priest is allowed behind that curtain to put his hands on the altar of the most holy place once a year. Okay? So basic setup of the tabernacle. In the holy place, the place where you are allowed to go and worship, is the lampstand and the table. And on that table is a piece or a jar full of manna to remind you of God's provision and his faithfulness, his renewed mercies, all of those things. This is what worship looked like in the desert. But I was struck by something as I read the construction of the Ark of the Covenant, because in the Holy of Holies, in the most holy place, was cherubim placed to guard the presence of God. And something else struck me. Can we look at chapter 27, verse 13? Something familiar. This is the tabernacle. It says, on the east end, toward the sunrise, the courtyard shall also be 50 cubits wide. On the east end. So every time they set up the tabernacle, because the tabernacle is a mobile unit, every time the entrance is to face east. Now, I don't know about you, but something strikes me as a little familiar about some of these things. And if you're thinking the book of Revelations, you would be correct. But that's not today's message. I want to go back to Genesis for a minute. Let me put up a verse from Genesis 3. Verse 23. So the Lord God banished him from the Garden of Eden to work the ground from which it had been taken. After he drove the man out, he placed on the east side of the garden cherubim and a flaming sword flashing back and forth to guard the way to the tree of life. God banished them from the garden to the east. The tabernacle is set up to be entered from the east. Cherubim guard the tree of life and the presence of God. God dwells in Eden. That's where he created the relationship between God and man to be, is in Eden. Cherubim guard the presence of God. In the tabernacle, cherubim guard the word of God, the Ark of the Covenant, the Holy of Holies, where the Spirit of God in the cloud has descended. What is God doing in giving his people the tabernacle? In Eden, they were banished from his presence. In the desert, they were welcome to it. They were invited to it. Go back to a picture of the tabernacle, please. See, we just read in that verse in Genesis that a sword swung back and forth, that anyone who tried to enter back into Eden, well, you know how swords work. It's going to cost you your life to enter the presence of God. It costs you your life to come into the presence of God. We come into the courtyard where life must be offered on the altar before going into the tent of meeting. Before meeting God, life is sacrificed. Old camp story. We had one very lovely lady come and speak with us 1 week. And her approach was rather unconventional, we shall say. But in a room full of 100 7 and 8-year-olds, she tried to describe what this process may have looked like. And in approaching the altar and trying to describe to these kids how Jesus has become our sacrificial lamb, she pulls from behind her a stuffed animal of a little lamb. And oh my word, she sacrificed this thing in front of a bunch of little children. She was not asked to come and speak again. However, she wasn't wrong. Jesus was the sacrificial lamb. So last week was Easter. That was last week, right? Because the temple was built on this concept as well. What happened at Easter that changed the temple? The curtain was ripped in two. The curtain that separated the holy place from the most holy place was ripped in two. God's presence dwells in the most holy place. So what happens when that curtain is ripped? The presence of God was released to dwell among the man. And this is where I get wrecked every time. Because as I was reading about the tabernacle on Easter weekend, the Holy Spirit breathed on these words and the elements of what the tabernacle was. I should mention before I get into it, we have this lampstand. I didn't talk about the lampstand yet. You guys know what the lampstand looked like? You guys seen a menorah at Christmas time? This lampstand has seven limbs on it. It's designed to look like a tree of life, which was protected in Eden in the presence of God. And it's to give light. It's a lampstand. So if you will, journey with me for just a second into the tabernacle, into the presence of God, to come before him in worship the way he designed for them in the desert. But journey with me as if Jesus was taking you there. For those of you who are visual and you want to close your eyes and visualize him taking you there, that'd be great. If not, just listen. Because the Holy Spirit lit this up for me. And every time. Enter into the courtyard, knowing that you can see the cloud. The presence of God is visually ahead of you. But Jesus takes you by the hand with this lamb that you have brought to offer as your sacrifice. He walks up to the altar, and just as you lift this thing going, "Lord, I am sorry for my sins," he puts his hands in the way and says, "Wait. I am the way, the truth, and the life." And pointing to the tent, he says, "No one comes to the Father but through me." And then he leads you up to that first curtain. And just before you march in there, knowing that you have a rightful place in the presence of God, he says, "But I am the door. I am the gate that leads to life." And you enter with Jesus, and you take a seat in the holy place, and you notice the light that is given off by the lampstand. It's crafted out of gold. You see the tree, you see the light. And Jesus says, "I am the light of the world. He who follows me will not walk in darkness." And you take your seat at the table, which on it you look at the bread, the manna, the symbol of God's provision and hope, his new mercies. And before you touch it, before you even look at it, Jesus pushes it to the side and says, "I am the bread of life. He who comes after me will not go hungry." And before pouring out a pitcher of wine, Jesus grabs that and says, "This is my blood of the new covenant poured out for you." And when you look up from the table and see that the curtain has been torn in two, that for the first time in your life, you are looking at the Ark of the Covenant, something that has been hidden from you, has been hidden from all mankind, sitting there in plain view, knowing that inside are the words of God chiseled out by his finger in stone. And Jesus says, "In the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God, and the Word was God. Through him and by him all things were made, that we may be called sons and daughters of God. That the Word of God dwelt among man." He was made flesh. "Made flesh and dwelt among man, that the glory of God may be revealed." And the last thing he says is, "Before Abraham was, I am." And the presence of God that you have entered the tent to seek is revealed to you as the presence that you carried into the tent. Jesus, the visible image of the invisible God, is the glory of God manifested. This wasn't the end of my journey this week. Actually, what kicked off and inspired this whole message was a video I came across of two members of my youth group from several years ago, and this movement that is taking place right now called the Deconstruction of Faith. It is a progressive Christianity movement. And in the Deconstruction of Faith, our church traditions, the Word of God is put under a microscope. And one by one, the truth is dissected. And for things that don't lead to happiness, they're simply discarded. Happiness has become the altar of truth in today's Christianity. Happiness is the altar that sacrifices the unborn. Happiness is the altar that compromises marriage, our sexuality, everything in the name of happiness. And if following God's way does not lead to happiness, then people don't want to follow God's way. I watched this video, which, I mean, it was made by people who I love dearly, who I walked through their adolescent years with and poured myself into daily. I love them so deeply that it rattled me to my core to watch this video. But in the deconstruction of faith, it became apparent to me that the promises they were holding on to weren't the promises that God made. This promise of happiness, as they see happiness, isn't biblical. And maybe as a church, we've done a disservice in preaching a gospel that says, here's all the things that God's going to give you when you receive Jesus. Maybe we have to take some responsibility for that. But in that revelation, something struck me. Can we go back to our opening passage, please? Exodus 33. Moses said to the Lord, "See, you say to me, bring up this people, but you have not let me know whom you will send with me. Yet you have said, I know you by name, and you have also found favor in my sight. Now therefore, if I have found favor in your sight, please show me now your ways, that I may know you in order to find favor in your sight. Consider too that this nation is your people." And he said, "My presence will go with you, and I will give you rest." And he said to him, "If your presence will not go with me, do not bring us up from here. For how shall it be known that I have found favor in your sight, I and your people? Is it not in your going with us, so that we are distinct, I and your people, from every other people on the face of the earth?" And the Lord said to Moses, "This very thing that you have spoken I will do, for you have found favor in my sight, and I know you by name." Moses said, "Please show me your glory." The conversation between God and Moses is, God, don't ever let your presence forsake us. And the promise God makes is that his presence would go with them forever. In the new world of Christianity, we are hung up on the promise of God, not the presence. And we fail to realize that the presence of God is the promise. As I read about the tabernacle, which is mobile, right? When the glory of God lifted from it, the Israelites knew it was time to move, and they would pick everything up. It says there was gold rings fastened to everything that they could slide poles through, because everything was mobile. Everything had to be moved to the next location and reset up where the presence of God would then come upon it again. Thought it was funny that we talk about the promised land as this destination. You know, it was the land that God had given to Abraham and his descendants, and you know, he kept it for them first to drive out the Canaanites, but it was their land, that was their promise. And they spent, I'm drawing a blank, 40 years wandering the desert in search of that promise. And the last thought that I want to leave you with today, as people, I don't know where you're at, maybe wandering a desert of your own looking for that promise. The promise of God wasn't what they entered into. It's what they carried along the way. Father, I thank you for the promise of your presence, that you go with us wherever we go, and your presence is what leads us. As we come into worship, we come with the freedom that the sacrifice has been made, so that way your presence is something that we can carry inside of us, not something that we have to chase or build or find. God, I praise you as promise carriers. And I pray that we would never forget what it means to carry that inside of us. I pray that we would never lose sight of that, that we would not get hung up and sacrifice on the altar of happiness as if happiness and godliness are equal. God, I just want to give you glory for who you are, give you all the praise that you're due. And I just pray over these people as we go on for the week to come, that we would be carriers of your presence into all the dark places. In Revelation, the lampstand represents the seven churches, because after you declared that you were the light of the world, you looked at your disciples and told them that they are the light of the world. God, may we be carriers of that light into your world. May we love others well. In Jesus' name.
calling? Have you come to the end of yourself? Do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ.
Something we did in the first service was just offer prayer to people if you're just in need of a fresh filling of the Spirit of God, or deliverance, or healing, or just encouragement. We as elders, there's Al, Arthur, Pastor Brian is here. We just wanted to offer and make available the opportunity to receive prayer. Al's already here at the front. I'll stay at the front. I've pointed out the others as well, but just don't be afraid to take up your eldership in the needs of prayer. We are a body and a community that are here to love one another. So let's continue to sing and worship.
Leave behind your regrets and mistakes. Come today, there's no reason to wait. Jesus is calling. Bring your sorrows and trade them for joy. From the ashes a new life is born. Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Isn't he wonderful? Sing hallelujah. Christ is risen. Bow down before him, for he is Lord of all. Sing hallelujah. Christ is risen. What a Savior, isn't he wonderful? Sing hallelujah, Christ is risen. Bow down before him, for he is Lord of all. Sing hallelujah. Christ is risen. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Thank you.
bear your cross as you wait for the crown. Tell the world of the treasure you found.
As our benediction this morning, I just hopefully will convey what I heard from Kevin, what Moses said, and what God said. Take me past the outer courts. Kind of overwhelming. Take me past the outer courts into the holy place, past the brazen altar. Lord, I want to see your face. Passing by the crowds of people, the priests who sing your praise. I hunger and thirst for your righteousness, and it's only found one place. Take me into the Holy of Holies. Take me in by the blood of the Lamb. Take me in to the Holy of Holies. And I think God's response to that is from Deuteronomy, when Moses is passing the torch to Joshua. Moses said, "The Lord himself goes before you and will be with you. He will never leave you nor forsake you. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged." As pastor would close the service, let's love one another this week. You are dismissed.